Brad Keithley, Managing Director of Alaskans for Sustainable Budgets. Welcome to the weekly top three, the top three things on our mind here at Alaskans for Sustainable Budgets for the week of October 26th, 2020. The weekly top three is a regular segment on the Michael Duke Show. The show broadcasts on Facebook Live and via streaming audio from the show's website, weekdays from 6 to 8 a.m. I join Michael weekly in the first hour of Tuesday's show from 6:25 to 7 a.m. for a discussion between the two of us about our three issues. We post the podcasts of our discussion following the show on the Alaska for Sustainable Budgets Facebook, YouTube, SoundCloud, and Spotify pages, also on the new Alaskans for Sustainable Budgets website, as well as the projects page on national blog site, medium.com. You can find past episodes of the weekly top three also at the same locations. Keep in mind that in addition to these podcasts, during the week, you also can follow and participate in the discussion with us of these and other issues affecting Alaska's fiscal and economic condition by following us on the Alaska for Sustainable Budgets Facebook page and through our posts on Twitter. This week, our top three issues are these. First, a final pre-election discussion between Michael, who leans no, and me, a yes, on Proposition 1, the oil tax initiative. Second, our thoughts on the proposal by some to use the PCE, Power Cost Equalization Fund, to plug a portion of next year's deficit. And third, there's a lot going on in other states with university funding that is relevant as well to Alaska. And now, let's join Michael.
All right, well, let's talk about the weekly top three. We're going to start off today with one last recap of Proposition 1, the he said, she said. You and I have been talking about this back and forth. I have still said that I was kind of undecided. You, surprisingly enough, an oil and gas guy with an oil and gas background, have come out in favor of it. I still have some serious challenges and issues regarding it. But let's get your rundown on this one more time.
Well, here's the ultimate crux of it, Michael. There isn't a no tax option. We have put ourselves in a hole where we don't really have a way out of it without taxing somebody. And the question is, what's the least worst of the options? Taxing Alaska families through additional PFD cuts has the largest adverse impact on the overall Alaska economy and Alaska families of any of the options that ICER studied in 2016. And you can layer oil taxes on top of that, and PFD cuts are still the worst option of any of the alternatives. So there's no tax option. PFD cuts are the worst, but PFD cuts are the fallback. That's what will happen if we don't come up with other options. As an oil guy from 35 years, I wish that we had other solutions than oil taxes, but we don't. And so I have to look at the adverse impact of an oil tax increase under Prop 1. Versus additional PFD cuts. That's what we've come down to. And as bad as they are, oil tax increases aren't as bad as the equivalent in PFD cuts. The oil taxes will increase. Prop 1 will increase overall oil costs about 5%. That's the increase in overall oil costs as the companies themselves project in increased transportation costs between 2019 and 2022, they're not screaming about that. And the reason they're not screaming about that is they can accommodate a 5% increase. It's not the thing they would like most, certainly, but they can accommodate a 5% increase. On top of that, under the Constitution, the Alaska, if Prop 1 turns into be an overreach, Prop 1 turns in as having problems, the Alaska legislature under the Constitution can amend Prop 1 at any time. It doesn't have to wait for any period of time to smooth out the rough edges. So I think it's not oh my God, tax those oil companies, they're bad. This is not a Robin Brenna. My position is not a Robin Brenna position. My position is There isn't a no tax choice. And so the question is, what's the least worst alternative in this situation? And I think Prop 1 produces part of the least worst alternative.
And of course, my main concern with Prop 1, again, I mean, I'm in agreement with Brad. I think there is some money to be that is still left on the table with oil companies, that we have a responsibility as Alaskans, and legislators have a responsibility from the Constitution, Article 1, Section 80 of the Constitution, to develop the resources to the maximum benefit of the people of the state of Alaska. And I believe that there is money left there, but my main concern is, do we reward bad behavior? We've already seen what they've done with the $20 billion that Brad was just talking about. Do we allow that? Do we give them more? Do we reward that bad behavior by giving them more? Do we take a kid who obviously can't control his money, who spends mom and dad's money, who does whatever he does, and then do we offer them another $100 bill? Do we give him a credit card, a blank credit card, and say, be good with this one? You've done well, but you know, you've done badly before, but we know this time you'll be good with it. That's my main concern, because giving them more money does not guarantee that they won't cut the PFD, does not guarantee that they won't use it as more road to kick the can down. And that's my main concern.
Yeah, and my response to that is it isn't more. It's a substitute. Let's look at it this way. Governor Dunleavy and 16 at some point will set the spending limit on whatever we're going to spend in FY22. Let's say that's $4 billion. Let's say they cut 15% out of the projected current law budget, and that's $4 billion. We have $2.3 billion in traditional revenues plus the leftover amount from the POMV draw. So that's a deficit of $1.7 billion. Where's that $1.7 billion going to come from? It's mostly going to come from PFD cuts. And my point is this. We can substitute about $370 million. That's the DOR projection of the incremental amount that Prop 1 will raise. We can substitute $370 million of that $1.7 billion that's otherwise likely going to come from PFD cuts. We can substitute $370 million of that by passing Prop 1. That's about $1,600 per average size Alaska family in terms of PFDs that we won't need to cut because we have a substitute from oil revenues. It's not more. We're not piling on more. Governor Dunleavy and 16 are going to set the spending limit. It's a question of how we finance within that spending limit. And it's either going to be PFD cuts or a portion of it's going to be offset with Prop 1. So I don't think it's fair to view this as more revenue for the legislature to play with. I think given the confines of the spending cap that the governor plus 16 will set, I think it's much better looked at as a substitute revenue source for what otherwise will be PFD cuts.
I guess I come back to the naivete, Brad, of saying, do you really think, in the fact that they've gone back to the PFD well again and again and again, that by giving them more revenue, $200 or $300 million, that they will once more go, oh, look, we could put that back into the PFD? Or do you think that instead they will try to save some other program that they otherwise would have cut because the revenue is just not there?
Well, the program they're otherwise going to cut is the PFD. I mean, you can't really argue with the arithmetic that the governor plus 16 are going to set the spending cap. You can't really argue with that. I mean, he's going to do it, and once you say that, it's a question of how you finance it. $2.3 billion from traditional revenue sources plus leftover POMV leaves a deficit of, let's say they cut 15%. Let's say they cut $700 million from the current law budget and get spending down to $4 billion. Dude, how are you going to finance that difference between $2.3 billion and $4 billion, the $1.7 billion deficit? It's not – they can create a bunch more – they can create a bunch more programs, but it's going to be within that confine. It's going to be a $4 billion spending cap. How are you going to finance that $1.7 billion deficit? The way they've done it the last several years, keep in mind, we're out of savings. The way they've done it the last several years is through PFD cuts. The only way to save the PFD, the only way to offset a portion of that is to have alternative revenues, substitute revenues. And that's what Prop 1 does. I just don't see the argument that it adds more because the governor plus 16 is setting the spending limit. It is a question of how you finance within that spending limit.
Of course.
And it's either going to come through PFD cuts or it's going to come through substitute revenue.
Of course, this assumes that the governor is going to come back with a thin budget, which we don't even know at this point. I mean, last year he blinked last year, came back with a standard steady budget. It's going to be a question. That is 100% for sure. All right. Well, Brad and I are not necessarily in agreement on this. Again, I have not decided to vote 100% yes or no on Prop 1. I'm leaning more towards the no side right now because of this. But you guys are going to have to make your own decision. Brad and I have made our arguments so far, and we'll see where we go from here. Stephanie says, I couldn't disagree more. Giving the government more money is just creating a bigger monster. I mean, I hate to beat a dead horse, Brad, but I just feel like, you know, if they have no money coming in and they have this deficit and the only way to fill it is with the PFD, and so they're going to look at filling this $1.7 billion gap that you're hypothesizing with a 15% cut. They're going to fill this $1.7 billion gap. They're going to look at the PFD and they're going to go, okay, well, we're just going to take it. Then you laud them with a windfall of another $300 million. And they're going to say, oh, look, well, we could still take the same amount from the PFD that we were going to take anyway, because that's what we've historically taken now for the last 5 years. And there's habit force built into that. And people are already kind of inured to it and ready for it. And now we've got $300 million that we can spend on more government that we would have cut. And we're still going to take the PFD. I mean, maybe I'm jaded. Maybe I'm just a little cynical. But that's what I feel like is going to happen. We've given them more wiggle room to leave something on the table by giving them this excess money. And they're still going to cut the full PFD in the long run.
Well, that assumes that spending is going to be higher than it otherwise would be. And I just don't agree with that. I mean, the governor, I think, is going to – I'm not sure why we're going through this election cycle of trying to elect conservative representatives if you don't agree with this. The governor is going to, I think, set a spending level, stick by it, get 16 to support it, and that's going to be the spending level. What the more argument is the governor is going to set that spending level, get 16 to stick by it, and then he's going to add another $370 million on top of that just because we passed Prop 1. I don't think the governor's going to do that. I don't think the 16 that we're looking to back up the governor are going to do that. If you assume that's going to happen, then everybody you've just elected is going to fail. You're assuming that everybody you've elected is
going
to fail.
I think,
I don't think that's a fair assumption.
Well, I mean, here's my thing. I mean, I'm the hope for the best and plan for the worst kind of guy, right? I hope we're right. I hope that we've elected conservatives who believe in smaller government. I hope that Governor Dunleavy will see the light in this budget cycle and say he can go back to his 2018 numbers of $800 million worth of cuts. I hope that can happen. But how many times have we been burned, Brad? How many times have we sent somebody down to Juno who said, this is what I believe and this is what I'm going to do, and then they get down there and they get pod peopled down there, and the next thing you know, they're telling us about how we just don't understand how the world really works and that they just can't cut anymore. That's my problem. I hope that what you're saying is right. The past performance is indicative of future results is kind of what I'm saying here.
Well, then ultimately the entire PFD is gone, and I'm not sure what we've been talking about for the past 10 years, why we've been talking about it for the past 10 years. I mean, if you assume that people are going to spend up to whatever they have, then the PFD is gone because they will ultimately take the whole thing, and then they'll come for them will come for an income tax. I don't assume that. I assume that we've elected people who are going to more or less do what they say they're going to do. The governor has said, give me a legislature that will back me up, give me 16 that will back me up, and I will cut spending. I assume I take him at face value and think he's going to do that. If he's not going to do that, if you assume that they're going to keep on spending until they run out of revenues, then the PFD's gone, and we're at the end times basically. So I don't make that assumption. I make the assumption that we're going to have a spending limit, that there's going to be 16 in the legislature to back him up, and what we're really talking about is where those revenues come from, as opposed to some unlimited pot of money.
I hope you are 100% right. I really do. I hope you're 100% right.
And if I am right, Michael, then Prop 1 makes a $370 million difference.
Yeah.
If I am right, if there is a spending cap that the governor will pass, 16 will back him up on, then raising $370 million through Prop 1 backs off $370 million, $1,600 per Alaska family that otherwise would come through PFD cuts. If I'm wrong, then the PFD's gone. I'm not sure what we're talking about.
Right. Well, if you're wrong, then we've just hastened, the demise of the permanent fund, which again puts the legislators back up against the wall further, because you can't keep tapping that well. Eventually, it will run dry, and then where will we be? And I think there would be such a backlash on that. I mean, you think this backlash is bad? Wait till you see what happens if something like that goes on. Like I said, I hope you're 100% right. I hope that my fears are completely unfounded. But I guess when it's all said and done, we'll see. Come next May or so. We need to start talking about number two, which is the Power Cost Equalization Fund, which finally has become part of the mainstream conversation. It's ironic that this has not. That this has not been part of the mainstream conversation for years. I mean, it's been talked about in political circles by people like Brad and I. But finally, we're backs against the wall. We're starting to look at all these pots of money, and all of a sudden, it's hit the mainstream conversation. Brad, you want to give us a tease before we go to break?
Yeah, I'm not sure the PCE conversation is going to lead us anyplace. PCE and the PFD share a common background. It is an effort to distribute the benefits of Alaska's wealth broadly among all Alaskans, both rural and urban. And going after PCE, going after the PCE $1 billion solves $1 billion of the $1.7 billion deficit we were just talking about. But at what cost? I mean, it has a cost to rural Alaska. And if you say we're going to offset that by just incorporating it now, PCE into the regular budget, we've not really gained anything, because we've grabbed $1 billion to offset a portion of 1 year's deficit, and we've done it at the expense of now sticking ourselves with a $60 to $75 million tab every year going out. If you're going to do that, the better course is to keep that $1 billion as a fund,
because it creates that $70 billion a year,
right,
in interest and everything else. So it's free
exactly.
money essentially, just by having it sit there. Right, welcome back to the program. Continuing now with Brad Keithley, the weekly top three. We're into number two. We've been talking about the Power Cost Equalization Fund. Some have seen it as a way out in the short term for a single year. Brad just made the argument, which I think is a valid argument, to say that if we take the PCE in total, we're basically encumbering the state for another $70 million a year moving forward, which is true, because the PCE now generates its own revenue. It generates that same $70 billion a year that they're spending. But I guess the question then becomes, if we don't use PCE or similar funds, higher education endowment funds and some others. Somebody said that they'd run a CAFR type analysis of the different state accounts, and said that was just a couple of the accounts, that all told that there was something like $6 billion in various accounts sitting around. So maybe PCE should be low man on the totem pole. But if we don't fill it with PCE, Brad, what is the other option, I guess, for Alaskans? What should we be pushing for if we're not pushing on PCE to fill the gap in the short term?
Well, we just had that conversation.
Right.
I mean, the answer is you've got to come up with that $1.7 billion. And it's not just next year. It's not just, if we can just raise $1.7 billion, there's light at the end of the tunnel. It's every year for the remainder of the decade. And so the question is, how are you gonna deal with that every year for the remainder of the decade? And I think it's a combination of spending cuts. We have to make major spending cuts. $700 million, which gets it down to $4 billion. That's 15% of spending. That's a huge amount. I mean, Governor Dunleavy, even in 2019, didn't come anywhere close to that. So we have to have some major spending cuts, and then we have to have some revenues to fill in on a consistent basis. Just going and grabbing pots of money to fill in a hole there. We did that during the 2010s. We used our savings accounts to do that. We kept telling ourselves, "Oh, it's just a fund, a glide path." Well, we never glided. We kept spending, and we consumed $20 billion. I have no more faith. You're talking about faith. I have no more faith that if we plug the gap by taking $1 billion from PCE and another $1 billion from the university, which is one of these CAFR accounts, and continuing to rob these funds, these trust funds, I have no more faith that we're going to actually have a glide path to a solution than we had in the 2010s. So we've got to face up to it. It's got to be a combination of spending cuts and some revenues, and hopefully more equitable revenues than we've come to with PFD cuts.
The PCE, for those of you who don't know, again, we've talked about it enough on the program, but just so you know, the Power Cost Equalization Fund is used to offset high rural energy costs. It helps pay for different types of energy, fuel oil costs, and other things. It's also used for energy projects in the bush. About half of it is used to offset, and about half of it is used for infrastructure investment to try and create some of these more low energy cost issues for rural communities. And it generates, because it's $1.1 billion roughly, it generates its own money because it's invested. And so it generates about $70 million a year on its own. So it essentially pays for itself. The money just sitting there essentially pays for itself. If we take it, then we would be on the hook because, again, it's statutory, although the legislature can decide to just ignore that at their whim. It is statutory that they pay these things, and otherwise we'd be on the hook every year for $40 to $80 million a year in those costs, right, Ben?
Yeah, exactly. It operates the same way as the retirement account does. We put a bunch of money into the retirement account to fund PERS and TERS, and that money we have in the retirement account generates income. It's invested, generates income every year. That helps supplement and pay for the PERS and TERS retirement obligations. If we didn't have that fund, if we didn't have the PERS and TERS fund, all of that obligation would come back into the general fund, and instead of roughly $300 million, we pay every year in PERS and TERS contributions out of the general fund. It'd be more than $1 billion we'd have to pay every year out of the general fund to fund PERS and TERS. So these funds that are set aside, and the ones that people have talked about being in the CAFR, these funds that are set aside are in order to take an obligation off of the general fund. And frankly, I've got to give Lyman Hoffman, I often complain about Lyman, but in this case I will give him credit. Lyman, at the time that we had, back in the early 2010s, when we had excess funds, when we had the surplus coming in, rather than spend it on another artificial turf football field someplace, they started putting money aside into the PCE fund to generate this sort of revenue that would generate enough revenue to pay for PCE and community. I think community assistance is the other thing that's paid out of that fund. And it was a genius move because it took that money away from those who wanted to spend it, as I say, on another artificial turf football field, took that money away from those who wanted to spend it and put it into a fund where it actually provides benefits going forward in terms of the earnings covering PCE costs. So it's a good use of funds. It is reducing the burden on the general fund, and I think it's very short. To me, it's just very short-sighted to go grab $1 billion out of there and plug a partial hole in just this year's budget. It is another way, frankly, of taxing future Alaskans, because you're going to be taking money that otherwise generates a benefit for future Alaskans, generates revenue for future Alaskans, reduces their obligation to the general fund, takes it for the benefit of this generation, but leaves future Alaskans stuck with the roughly $70 million a year bill to pay for PCE and community assistance. So I understand why people say, oh, $1 billion, let's go use that. Well, it's the same thing with the CBR and SBR. It was, you know, $20 billion, let's go use that. Well, we saw what that got us. It got us nothing.
Right, right. Harold just can't decide. He's just so mad about Brad all the time. He just can't agree with anything. He's now mad that Brad said something about AstroTurf fields. The artificial turf fields being played around the state, that was just like a symptom of a larger problem. That the state, when they just decided, we're going to just spend money on stuff and things. When you've got an artificial turf field that can only be used for 3 or 4 months out of the year and you spend $1 million on it, you got to start asking yourself, maybe you've got too much money. I'm sorry. If regular fields don't work for you, if a regular grassy field is just not enough, then maybe, you know, just knocking rural schools. I don't think it's a knock on rural schools. What I think it is a knock on is I think it's a knock on oversized government spending. That is, the bottom line, Brad.
Yeah, absolutely. The AstroTurf football fields largely happened in Anchorage. And what we did was take... Was we had a good central facility, Alaska Football Stadium, and rather than improve it and continue to make it the central football stadium, we decided that all these high schools needed their own football stadiums for 4 games a year, and that we needed to put AstroTurf football fields at all these high schools. It was one of those examples where you have so much money. It proved Lyman Hoffman right. I mean, it was one of those examples where you have so much money, you don't know what to do with it. You come up with ideas like astroturfing football stadiums at every high school in Anchorage. Lyman was right to set aside the PCE money. I mean, he saved it from being spent on something else. No, the AstroTurf football field is largely a knock on Kevin Meyer, who loved going to the openings of all these stadiums and who took great pride in setting aside capital budgets or appropriating capital budgets for those football stadiums.
Donna Ardwin is in the chat room. She says PCE funds are borrowed from and owed to the CBR, which I was not aware of. Is that something that's in your realm there, Brent?
Oh, that's the whole reverse sweep argument, Michael. So the argument is, if you don't do the reverse sweep, that the PCE funds spill into the CBR. They're set aside for a specific purpose. They're not like normal CBR funds during the 2010s that were sitting around without designation, without serving a purpose, just sitting there to be spent on whatever the next legislature decided to spend them on. The PCE funds are set aside for a specific purpose. Maybe you want to argue about the specific purpose. Maybe you want to argue that rural Alaska ought to be paying more for its energy, a lot more for its energy than urban Alaska, and that would be an argument to do away with PCE. But as long as you accept the premise that the wealth of the state ought to be spread broadly to all parts of the state, then PCE is the PCE fund's a very good way to do it.
Well, and I think what it is an argument for more than anything else, not necessarily for the argument that you just made, but that there is the Constitution basically argues against designated funds. And whether you call them dedicated funds or designated funds, if the regardless of the verbiage, if it's the same thing, then basically it's an attempt to circumvent the protections that are put in the Constitution.
Well, you can argue that the set asides for the retirement accounts are that. You can argue, I mean, if you're going to go down that direction, you can argue that the permanent fund dividend shouldn't be sacrosanct. We have decided in the legislature, and it can be undone by subsequent legislatures, the Supreme Court has told us, but we've decided over the years in the legislature there are certain things that ought to be set aside, that we ought to have as a continuing program. And one of those, we decided by statute, ought to be the permanent fund dividend. We ought to go back to that. We ought to observe that. Another one is PCE. Another one's retirement. And those make sense. I mean, they're sort of programs that you say, yes, we're going to continue this program. It's so important. We're going to continue this program, and we're going to make sure we have funding for it by setting aside a fund for it.
Let's move on to number three. We've got about 5 minutes left here. Number three, of course, is we've been talking about the university. University in Alaska here is not the only one that's having to deal with issues and cuts and everything else. You've got an example on that, and I wanted to talk about it.
Yeah, there was a great article yesterday in the New York Times, of all places, but a great article yesterday. Headline, Colleges Slash Budgets in the Pandemic with Nothing Off Limits. Sometimes when you listen to the university and its advocates here in the state, it's like, oh my God, you know, we're doing something here in Alaska that's not happening anyplace else. We're cutting back our university, impairing our university system at the time that, you know, everybody else is doing great. All the other university systems are doing great, and somehow we're doing undue prejudicial disadvantage to ourselves as a result of that. It's not true. Colleges throughout the nation, and this article does a great job of summing it up, colleges throughout the nation are facing very similar circumstances. One example that they gave in the article, state governments from Washington, this is a quote from the article, state governments from Washington to Connecticut have told public universities to expect steep cuts in appropriations. Pennsylvania is merging a half dozen smaller schools, and smaller schools in Pennsylvania are bigger than UAF, UAA, and UAS, are merging a half dozen smaller schools into two academic entities. Other states are taking the steps that we need to be looking at in Alaska. I think the merger approach, consolidating universities, is something that certainly that we ought to be looking at in Alaska. And we're seeing other states doing it. So we're not, when people try to tell you, oh my God, we're hurting our university system, Alaska's going to fall behind even further, the other 49 states. Not true. Everybody's going through this. And a lot of places are coming up with good ideas, like Pennsylvania's merger, of its quote, smaller universities. Into more consolidated entities. It's not true. Other places are coming up with good ideas. We ought to be looking at those other places and bringing their best ideas back to Alaska and using it in right sizing, downsizing, appropriately sizing our own university system.
Brad Keithley is our guest, Alaskans for Sustainable Budgets. Again, the argument is, Brad, we could consolidate these universities and save a lot of money in the long run and make everything more efficient. Less than a minute here. Final thought.
Absolutely. Pennsylvania's doing it. Other places are doing it. We should be looking at it, too.
All right. If you want to find out more about what Brad's talking about, whether you agree with him or not, you want to argue with him, Facebook is the perfect place for that. You can find him on Facebook at Alaskans for Sustainable Budgets, or ak4sb.com is their website. We're down to the last 90 seconds or here. So, Brad, I'll give you the floor if you want to make your pitch for the election or anything else. Your final thoughts, I guess, before we run into election week here.
My final thoughts is elect the most fiscally conservative candidate you have the opportunity to vote for. We are facing a decade that's even worse because we don't have savings than the decade we just came out of, because we don't have savings and we have low oil prices. That's even worse than the decade we just came out of. We need as fiscally conservative a legislature as we possibly can have. So vote for as many fiscal conservatives as you can find.
All right. Brad Keithley, Alaskans for Sustainable Budgets. My friend, thank you so much for coming on board and arguing with me this morning. It was fun. I enjoyed it.
Michael, as always, thanks for having me.
It's good stuff, my friend. Thanks for coming on board and being part of it today.
Well, that's a wrap for another week's edition of the Weekly Top 3 from Alaskans for Sustainable Budgets. Thank you again for joining us. Remember that you can find past episodes on our YouTube, SoundCloud, and Spotify pages, and keep track of us during the week on Facebook and Twitter. This has been Brad Keithley, Managing Director of Alaskans for Sustainable Budgets. We look forward to you joining us again next week on the Weekly Top 3.